Right, so do you believe in giving everyone a trophy day?
No,
No.
absolutely not. You don't, you know what? If you want to be an elite athlete, you don't get a prize for just showing up. You have to show up and excel to get trophies and to get ribbons and to get medals.
Yep, I agree.
Yeah,
I
but
understand.
society at this time embraces a mediocrity and they want normal.
Hey everyone, welcome to The Row Show. This week we have Cindy Ishoy, dressage equestrian rider, coach, and Olympic bronze medalist. In 1979, Cindy became the first Canadian to win an international dressage Grand Prix event at Greenwood, England, and she was the youngest equestrian competitor at the Munich Olympics at age 20. She also won a bronze medal with her team in 1988 in Korea on her famous horse, Dynasty. Now a coach and mentor for many young aspiring riders, Cindy and I discuss what it takes to be a high-level athlete, her philosophies on coaching, and how the horse and rider have to work together as a team to achieve great results. She also describes how she introduced pop music into her freestyle routine and the relationship all riders have with their equine partners. If you are a coach looking for a unique perspective on the athlete and coach relationship, this episode's for you. All right, everyone, let's go. Hey Cindy, thanks so much for coming on the show. You definitely have a really interesting background here with some of the situations you've been in with your sport. I see a lot of, let's say, parallels with gymnastics and training horses and all that. How are you doing?
I'm great, and thank you very much for having me. It's exciting for me as well.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's not necessarily a perspective that a lot of coaches really think about coaching when they're at least dealing with other humans. But when you kind of get out of that sort of paradigm, you realize, okay, there's a lot of similarities and things we can learn from. So it's quite a pleasure to have you on the show.
Well, thank you.
Well, first for our audience, since we're not really horse people at the end of the day and equestrian insights and all that, can you give us a little bit of background of what dressage is and what your background is in it?
Yes. Well, dressage, actually, the word dressage is a French verb, which means to train. So dressage, how I do it, is we train animals to perform exercises, and then we have tests that we have to ride, so compulsory movements, if you want to compare it to figure skating. And then we have to, then we have other ones, the freestyles that we do as well. So we have to do the compulsory figures, and then we have to do the freestyle where we do compulsory figures, how we want to do them or how we would like to present them. And that's basically what it is. And so the thing is with us, you gymnasticize the horse, and then you train the riders as well together.
Okay, so it's together. It's a cooperation, a partnership. It's not individually done, like the horses in one place and the athletes somewhere else. It's all done together.
If you want to be excellent, you train together. There are times, there are people that will buy trained horses and then learn to ride those horses that other people have trained.
Oh.
But I prefer that when you train the athlete, the horse, and the rider together.
Well, I would agree, because then you kind of feel what they're feeling. You're literally riding. When we talk about other athletes working with their surfboards or any piece of equipment of any kind, they really tell us that they have to feel it, and that you can't just do that by training by yourself. You need to be with the equipment, the weight of it, the feeling of it, all that stuff really does matter.
It absolutely does, and you're dealing with very different temperaments. Like people, horses have different temperaments. You have lazy horses. You have horses that bring it every day. You have horses that you have to calm down. So you have to learn to deal with those things with your own temperament and how to make it work so that you can both be excellent at the right time on the right day.
Yeah, I can definitely imagine. So you're mirroring each other. So if the horse comes in one day, it's all sluggish, then isn't it the rider's job to kind of perk it up and give a little, Rocky Balboa motivational speech?
Well, yes, it is. Actually, yes, it is. Unfortunately, it's not verbal, but yes, you have to, there are days that they don't bring it, and you have to eke that out of them in a positive way that it still looks harmonious, and there are days that they save your life. in the ring, in the competition ring. So if you're a little bit off, and they're like, okay, I'm there for you. So for sure, there is that relationship with horses. And then there are horses that every day give 110%. And much like training athletes, you have athletes that come ready every day, and you have athletes that don't come every day. And some of the most talented, naturally talented athletes don't make it because they aren't as committed as the ones that have to work harder.
When you guys are training and you're coming, showing up to the day, when the athlete is going a little bit slow, let's say the horse will pick them up. The horse will kind of literally lift them up, even if the rider is supposed to be somewhat controlled, at least from the public opinion.
Yes, they will. Some days. I mean, some days you're both off, and that can happen. I mean, if you think of figure skating as well, like sometimes your partner can bolster you and you know, hold you a little longer or stronger, or they can drop you, right?
Yeah.
And so you hope that you're not both off on the same day, and you sure don't want to be off at the Olympics or the World Championships or the major competitions. But yes, they definitely can bring you to it. Like, I've seen riders that are somewhat comatose going into the area that we compete, and the horse will then sort of bring them back to reality, and like, you've trained your whole life for this, so let's do it. And yes, you have that, and vice versa.
Well, that's really interesting, because, you know, public opinion wouldn't understand that aspect, that bonding relationship. You know, we have one of our athletes that works with an elephant and trains this elephant to do teeter board with him. And he'll sometimes get criticisms, but the reality is that there's that bond, and you can see the elephant bonding with him. It's not anything much more than a friendship that you would have with a regular person.
It's true. I mean, you become a part, you become a partnership and a part of each other.
That's very interesting.
I mean, when Dynasty, my top horse, died of colic a year after the Seoul Olympics, I lost my best friend.
Okay.
He always, every day, he brought it 110%. You know, he was unbelievable. And I to have had an animal like that, and that relationship and that connection with an animal was humbling to me, because how many times can you have that in a lifetime with an animal as well as a human, quite frankly?
I agree with you there. Yep. There's definitely a lot of similar wiring there. And yeah, it's everyone looking for that kind of relationship. So when your horses are, let's say, having the best day, what can the coach or the rider or the athlete do to kind of, you know, put a little pep in their step?
Well, it's a training thing, and there's also repetition builds confidence and excellence. So if you're struggling in a day, then you would take it down a notch, and you would go to the basics of training and the suppling work and the flexibility work to build the horse back up to a place of confidence and feeling good. I mean, like us, they have sore muscles. They, you know, they had a bad night. They didn't sleep so well. They kicked the stall and they hurt themselves somewhat. They can't tell us verbally that, but they can't, if you listen to them, they can tell us that they're not on. So as an athlete, as a rider, and as a coach, you have to be able to analyze that. And sometimes the coaches, I was lucky enough to have the best coaches in the world, they can feel that and see that more quickly than the rider can, because the rider is sort of invested in the Olympics or the World Championships or the Aachen, the biggest horse shows in the world. So sometimes you will overlook that as a rider, and the coach will see that the horse isn't what it should be on that day, and then a good coach will take it down to the basics and make the horse comfortable and make the rider understand that.
Yeah, it sounds like the more experienced coaches are the ones that can, let's say, look at the subconscious motivations, attitudes of the horse or any animal or any athlete, and kind of see what's really going on underneath the hood, sort of thing. And
absolutely.
Yeah, and then the younger coaches are still more, they still tend to, at least from my experience with dealing with lots of coaches, and we do a lot of coaching clinics all around the world with lots of different sports and all that sort of stuff. And the one thing I keep seeing is that the inexperienced coaches focus more on the verbal cues and get frustrated easier when they just don't seem to work their first line of defense. And they never get to the subconscious aspect, which I think is really interesting, because your guys is all subconscious.
It really is. And I mean, there is a conscious, a very clear, like, you can see it so clearly. But there's a feel. I mean, it's really hard to explain unless you have felt it. And I mean, I think any athlete that's in the zone, let's use that term, the feeling of euphoria and accomplishment and connection to what you're doing is so astronomical that you it is something you cherish. And if you've never felt that as an athlete, it's very hard to coach that.
Yeah, you can't create subconscious motivations for people. You know, you kind of get an athlete when they come to the door, at least in the gymnastics world, and they're refilled their heads with lots of stuff from mom and dad and society and whatever else. So you're kind of getting a mixed bag, you know, and that's kind of tough for some coaches because they really just struggle to really, let's say, look in the bag and start figuring out what it actually is and be able to give the proper treatment, let's call it, to the athletes, where they're, some are high performance, some are wreck, and it's tough to find exactly what that motivation is without really just kind of being there with them.
Yes, and also you have to, like, when you're training for major international competition, you have to leave your ego at the door. I mean, you have to be completely connected to your coach and trust your coach, and your coach has to be invested in making you be the best you can be. And sometimes it's not nice. I mean, if you're told you're pretty and you're lovely all the time, all you do then is encourage and create mediocrity.
Yeah.
Because it's not always pretty and it's not always nice and it doesn't always feel good. But your goal is, when you get 2 or 3 seconds of that feeling of connection with the animal, with the situation, with the movement that you're doing, then through that, those few seconds on an ongoing basis, the seconds become minutes, become a quarter of an hour, a half an hour, and then you get that performance in the ring. But if you're always told it's good, which seems to be society's thing right now, then that's exactly what you are, good, not excellent.
Well, it's interesting. It's also relative, right? So do you believe in giving everyone a trophy day?
No.
No.
Absolutely not. You know what? If you want to be an elite athlete, you don't get a prize for just showing up. You have to show up and excel to get trophies and to get ribbons and to get medals.
Yeah, it's almost like showing up is really just attending the competition itself. That's not even part of the game, really.
Yes.
It's like, well, because then you retract it back. It's like, oh, well, then do I also get a medal for getting up that day too before I even went to the competition? Oh, and then infinite backwards, and then you got nothing.
Well, I think it doesn't make you hungry. That doesn't, well, I got a medal too, yay, aren't I special, right? Because I showed up, right? I have a big problem with that. I have a very big problem with that. I'm not talking about, you know, 3-year-olds and 4-year-olds and everything, but I think it starts young to encourage people to be better than that last performance.
Well, because the thing, if you get them young, you already built that expectation. So by the time they do get to competitive, they've already expected the answer, you know, that trophy early. So it does start, I think, as soon as possible, as long as the parents can pay attention and society, and we can create some of those behaviors earlier on. I think a lot of people misunderstand how early that stuff sets in.
I totally agree. I mean, it starts in school where you pass, right?
Yep.
I mean, if you don't get the marks, you don't pass, or you shouldn't. You have to do the work, and it's not the teacher's job. It's the teacher's job to teach you to do the work, and it's your job to do the work. It's my job to coach somebody to excellence, and it's their job to do the homework to be the best they can be.
Yeah, I agree 100%, because it's like we kind of think of it like being a tour guide, right? I can lead you there, but at the end of the day, if you don't actually want to be on this mountain, there's no information I can give you that will help you.
That's right, and I am not saying that you are negative with people, but I mean, I think a good coach always supports a negative with a positive. Like, you, if you are in a bad place in your training thing, if you as a coach can't turn that around and get some time where you have accomplished something that you didn't think possible, you're not a good coach.
Well, that's interesting that you say that, because even when I was starting coaching, and I totally caught myself doing this before I started really thinking about it, I would always say something like, oh, hey, you know, Johnny, that was a great backflip. Oh, but you got to do this. And I always do that. And I caught myself. And now it's always, hey, Johnny, that was a great backflip. It was so good that I feel like you could do this next step. And then that's yes. who I switched my brain to, and it made all the difference.
Yeah, it's very, very true. But I mean, there's also a discipline thing too. That's very much lacking in sports. Where I trained in Germany with the best coach of our time, he didn't allow other people to watch you train. Like you trained, your training session with him was your training session with him. So parents weren't allowed to watch, and guests weren't allowed to watch, because he said, when people are watching, you're performing, you're not training. They can watch you in the show ring. They can watch you in the competition ring. And that's when they'll see the results of all this training. But when people are watching you that aren't training you, then you are performing for them, and then you're covering up your weaknesses, and you have to work on your weaknesses to excel.
We're also potentially showing your weaknesses.
Yeah, exactly.
And we see that a lot. You know, it's kind of interesting because the older traditional sports, including gymnastics and even snowboarding now, is being a little bit more traditional considering everything. And they'll keep their routines or their half pipe whatevers to themselves. And they'll actively say, yeah, I don't post that online unless I'm doing a magazine shoot or something like that. But when yes. you have all these new kids now and they're just posting their stuff all online because that's kind of where this social digital sports kind of stuff is now propagating. And there is no, keep your cards hold to your chest. And it's a different dynamic.
It is a different dynamic, and it doesn't produce excellence.
Oh, so you think that if there was a community that kind of always showed everyone training videos and all that sort of stuff, which is legitimately what the freestyle guys do, you think that that would mean, if I compared it, everything else being equal, to a closed system, you would have higher ranking results in the long term?
I think you would, yeah. Yep. Ooh. I mean, we all go and watch our heroes. I was in Aachen, which is one of the biggest, or it is the biggest horse show in the world, in Germany. And I was in my 20s, and I was sitting there watching, and there was some British people behind me. And Reiner Klimke, who was the hero of the moment, brilliant, brilliant trainer rider. And he made mistakes, a big mistake in two tempo flying changes, which is a flying, you have to know dressage, a flying change every second stride. So, and that's, a fairly big movement. But the next movement was one tempo, which is like when a horse skips across the diagonal and you have to do 15 one tempo straight. And so this horse was a young horse, green in the ring, and it took off bucking, like that he stayed, that he didn't fall off, that how badly it was bucking, that he didn't fall off was speaks to how brilliant a rider he was. So the people behind me go, oh, well, look at that. See, he even makes mistakes. He makes mistakes. So then he sat the horse back on his hocks and went around the corner through the gymnastic training that he did. And that's when you go back to the basics of training. And that's when you have to know that to excel. Set the horse back, came across and did the one tempo. So our scoring is from 0 to 10. 10 being the highest you can get.
Okay.
They were so beautiful, so clean, that, I mean, if I was a judge, I would have given him a 10 because there was no fault. Right?
Yeah.
And the evenly placed in that. But they saw the negative. I saw the positive. That if a rider can do that, they're brilliant. Because to refocus a young horse, a nervous young horse, to refocus them, you have 20 meters from one movement to the other meter. To refocus, to get them rebalanced, to you get your head back together, to counting 15 without, the stress of, because when it goes wrong at those major competitions, it can be unsettling for both horse and rider. And it was just unbelievable. But they were like, oh, well, look, yeah, he can make mistakes. And I'm like, well, we all make mistakes, but look at how he fixed it. Could many other riders do that? No.
Wow, that's interesting, because we present, and it's you've seen girls in gymnastics, especially girls, they have to walk onto the floor the right way, they have to leave the floor the right way, the whole thing's a presentation, and that's simply exactly what you're saying, is that if you stumble on little stuff like that, oh, well, she can't even walk up the stairs onto the floor and present to the judges. She must suck, right? And then it kind of plants that seed of doubt.
And then there is a negative aura in the air.
Yep. Exactly. And then you never really recover from that.
No, you don't. So yeah, I think that training should be private and should be, and plus, like, when you're training and somebody's going, like, it's so distracting.
That's interesting. You know? Yeah, because these guys, they post their stuff online looking for comments. Now, see, the flip side of it is that they get a lot of help from the community. They get a lot of positive support. And usually the bullying is very minimal, if non-existent for generally, because everyone's open. It's all open hand. You all kind of see each other. But it's interesting to see if as freestyle trampoline or what all these kind of freestyle sports become a little bit more...
Because I coach and there are a lot of other people riding at the same time in the warm-up rings. And yes, of course, there are always people that are rooting for you and, you know, come out to see you because you're their hero and everything. And you can't let that affect you either. You have to have your head in the game, and you have to have skin in the game to be successful. I mean, when I competed in Seoul, I'm told that a baby fell out of the stands, and there was all this kerfluffle and all this noise and all this stuff going on that, you know, can be very distracting for a horse and everything. And the people, somebody said, Cindy, didn't that bother you? That baby screaming and everybody running around. And I'm like, what baby? Right?
Yeah.
Like, I didn't hear anything because I was that focused at that moment on that day. I trained so many years for that. I'd given up so much of my life. I tried easy things in my life. I don't feel I gave up anything because I had a great life. But people would have considered it. Like, I didn't go to my graduation. I didn't go to parties. I didn't, you know, so people consider that part of giving up. I have never felt that I've lacked in anything in that respect. So, because I loved what I did. Well, but I literally did not know there was a kerfuffle at that end of the ring.
That is crazy. So you blocked all that out. You were hyper focused, and you just said, "You know, I'll deal with it after," and that's all it is. Because I know it's the same way for me. Like when I'm going, you try to talk to me, even when I'm just standing waiting for my turn, I'll completely ignore you, and it won't even be on purpose. I'll just, oh wait, what? You're here? What? What do you want?
What do you say? Well, that exactly. Like people think you're snobby, but you are so focused, you're not even aware they're in your space.
Exactly. They don't. They just don't exist in my reality.
Yeah, exactly. And but then I have parents that of kids that are super talented that I teach. Well, they've got to go to the party, and I don't think it's good that they do this, and I don't think it's good that they do that. And, you know, they can't just ride. They can't just do this. And, like, my inside voice is going, why? What? Right? If that's what they love, if this is their passion, why don't you embrace it? Well, I mean, I don't think that I'm antisocial. Maybe I'm a little weird, but I don't think that I'm...
We're all a little weird.
I'm pretty normal. Yeah. And, I mean, I've been all over the world, and I've met royalty, and I've had an amazing life through my sport. Because my parents, particularly my father, let me be what I wanted to be instead of try to make me be the norm.
You know, popular opinion is everyone needs a balanced life. Well, I don't...
Now, what is that?
Exactly. Well, what is that? Because if the way I see it is that if what I love is what I love, and that's thing A, then why wouldn't I give my entire focus as everything I could manage to that thing, despite what it is? Why would I purposely share it out for this thing called a balanced life so everything's mediocre?
Yes.
No, I agree.
Yeah, but society at this time embraces a mediocrity, and they want normal.
I think it makes them feel better, because if you have someone that's way above, then it just reminds you, you know,
and they embrace mediocrity. Right?
Yep, exactly. It's all that sort of stuff.
And then I came back to Canada and started training here, and then continued on with my career here.
That is very, very cool. So you've had a full life in this thing.
I think so. I think I've been very lucky.
Yeah, well, no, but it wasn't luck, though, because like you said, it takes a lifetime of work, dedication, you're focused more than, let's say, the average bear, and that's what you get at the end of the day. You get a great career, hopefully doing what you love. Do you notice a difference between, like, let's say, the American side of athletes and then the European side of athletes? Are they kind of the same, or is there a difference in training mentalities?
Oh, there's a complete difference in training mentalities. I mean, mind you, the excellence will always rise to the top. I mean, whether you're American, Russian, German, British, excellence will always rise to the top.
Why do you think that is?
Motivation, self-motivation, self-drive, the desire to be better than, the desire to be excellent, the desire to improve, the tenacity, the stick-to-itiveness, the all of those words. I mean, those athletes will always be at the top.
I agree. There's something there that they are chasing, I find. And I don't know what it is, but I know I'm running away from some of my fears, and that's putting me into the position to try to conquer them, right? So I'm doing a complete 180 from where, you know, I feel like I don't want to go, and I'm running as fast as I can. And that's, I think that's from the athletes I've talked to, a lot of them feel the same way. They're running.
Yes. Yeah. It's true. And you know, that's why it's very hard for me to watch what's going on in sport on many levels, because it's not going to work, right?
What do you mean?
You can't put out a minimum effort or a mediocre effort or just a financial effort and expect excellence. Like, it hurts psychologically, it hurts emotionally, it hurts physically at different times. And you have to have the strength and the tenacity and the will to get through that, to be excellent.
So do you think that over the years, people or athletes have softened up, to use the lack of a better term?
I think the average athlete, yes. I don't think that athletes that are excellent have, because they are still on the top of their game. I mean, when I look at these top hockey players and these top runners and the top gymnasts, and they can't be soft. They're just too good, the top ones.
Yeah, so it's almost like in economics. There's that growing space in between the middle class, where the 1% just keeps getting more because they drive the price up because they're controlling the show, and then it's almost like everyone else just slowly loses, and that's at least what the graphs are showing. Do you see kind of maybe a similar pattern in sport?
Yes, I do.
That is very interesting. Oh, I can understand that. Okay, because I see it. It's interesting. I come in from what I guess is very opposite of your sport, where everything is flex and we're just holding positions as tight as we can for 4 hours straight, basically. But you guys are saying, no, you know, I need to feel the horse. I need to be in rhythm with the horse.
Yes.
And that's more important than just over muscling. Because don't you get into a power struggle with the horse?
Well, and you lose every time.
I could beat a horse. Come on.
No, not if they want to win. No.
It becomes like a bull then, right? At the end of the day, if it gets that extreme.
Well, you know what you do is you break their heart. That's what happens. And they go like, why bother even trying to do anything?
Oh.
It's like a child that's nagged to death. It's like an athlete that's nagged to death. The most talented athlete will give up if you're always picking at them.
That's very interesting. So you are really kind of judging the horse. Would you say the horse is leading the training on an average day?
Yes. Leading the training by riding them. And so every day you get up, you have a program, a plan for your horse.
Okay.
You don't, a goal for what you want to accomplish that day on your horse. What exactly do you want to work on? Do you want to work more on the canter? And so at the upper levels at Grand Prix, you can't train every single thing in the Grand Prix every single day and expect the horse A, to stand up, and B, to do the job in a happy way. So you think you also don't ride the test over and over and over again, because that's A, boring, and B, it's not gymnastic. So you would say, okay, today I'm going to work on my canter tour. And in the canter tour, I'm going to highlight the flying changes and the half pass work. So you would work on all the prerequisites and the suppling work and the strengthening work to do that, and then you would work on the half pass. So like a training exercise in half pass would be a long half pass across the whole arena. You would do collected canter, so a slow, controlled canter, very active behind, into a working canter, into a medium canter, always holding the shape of the half pass, back to collected canter, to the flying change. So that's a strength training, a suppling, and it's good for their brain, right? And so if you're in the ring and you run into trouble, you have the ability, because you've trained it, to either shorten the stride in the canter or lengthen the stride in the canter to get the job done.
Okay.
So we lead them, but they tell us how to train them according to their strengths and weaknesses, if we are smart enough to listen.
That's very interesting, because in gymnastics, it's definitely not like that. You know, some of the coaches will pretend to say that they do that very well because the kids all smile when they come, but they don't understand that it's a much deeper issue, and they tend to forget that the athlete has to lead at let's say from the subconscious level, the rhythm that you have to get into with the athlete or the horse, you know, they have to start that rhythm at the end of the day, and then you can join in at their pace. And I think a lot of coaches don't understand that. And I think that's what's interesting about your sport, because it really highlights that.
Yeah, and the other thing is that you never push a horse past their mental and physical capacity. Well, a good coach and a good trainer never pushes a horse past their mental and physical capacity on a daily basis. And you push out of the comfort zone, because you don't improve if you don't go out of your comfort zone. And then you finish off with something the horse is very, very good at. And that's something you should do when you train a human athlete as well. You don't finish on something that they didn't do well or that they're really struggling with. You finish with something that they are very good at and say, okay, you know, this is how we're going to finish our training. Because otherwise the negative input plays on their head, and then they can't get out of their own head.
Well, that's very interesting, because then, yeah, the way we say it when we do our coaching clinics is always end on a good note.
Yes, yes.
And how do you know when a horse is going to get to that serious level? How do you, like, can you look at a horse when they're young and say, yep, in 4 years, you're going to be the one?
Yes and no. You can, if they have good conformation, so they're well built, if they move well, they have good gait, and if they have a brain. And I'm going to say that the brain is the most important thing. I mean, you can't have a badly put together horse that can't move go to the Olympics. I mean, that you just can't do.
Right.
You know, but if they have those three things, and your training program is good, and they have the mental capacity to keep it together through the training, you can do that.
Okay.
I mean, in my whole career, I can think of three horses that just didn't have it together. They learned everything in the Grand Prix, but they just couldn't not keep it together mentally to be competitive. Like, they were Grand Prix horses, but they weren't competitive internationally Grand Prix horses.
Because they were nervous or just didn't want to ride?
No, they didn't have enough skin in the game.
What does that mean? Like, how do you?
Some of our most talented horses don't make it to top international competition because their brain can't take it.
But when you say their brain, can you train their brain to take it, or can you look for cues?
You can train their brain to take it to a certain degree. I mean, how many athletes do you know, and I'm sure a lot, that are international quality, but they just can't get it together on the day?
Yeah, and there's a lot of people that have anxiety.
Over and over again, they just can't get it together on the day.
It's probably one of the most discussed topics.
And that happens too. And they have sports psychologists, and they have this, and they have that. So we have tons and tons of things to try and make it easier psychologically for the horse. And, you know, they have downtime. They have time where they just go out and hack and don't train hard, or they train out on hacks versus in the ring. I mean, there are hundreds of ways to try and make that feasible. But there are horses that just don't have it to keep it together on the most important day.
Would you say that the top riders in the world are those that come and bring it every day, and the horse can feel that?
Yes, absolutely, yes.
So it's funny, because you're saying that the horse kind of leads and you guys guide, but at the end of the day, that brings the horse to that level is actually the athlete's, let's say, positive attitude. So it's a draw.
Yes, it is. It is definitely that.
That is very, very cool. Have you ever had a horse that just, like, was perfect, everything's good, you had the best rider in the world, and then, I don't know, for whatever reason, the horse had a nightmare about, I don't know, not having enough hay or something, and then woke up the next day and just, it didn't work, like, instantly?
Well, I've had horses lose their heart, yeah.
Really? Is it fast, or is it, like...
It usually happens over a period of time, but it can happen overnight.
Really?
You've stressed them and stressed them and stressed them and stressed them and pushed past their capacity, and then they just give up.
They just break.
Yep. And just like people.
Yep.
Just like people.
And how do you know that they've broken from a horse? You're like, they're panting more, or they just droop their head more, or what's...
They don't try. They stop trying. And their eyes go dull, and they get a very unhappy. Horses can look happy. They can look just like dogs. Horses can look happy. They can look unhappy. They can be fresh and excited about the day, or they can come out and go, ugh, not another day. Just like people. If you learn to read them.
That is very cool. Well, what I've learned so far from just hearing your interpretation of how you train horses is exactly the way that I would say, at least the research says, you should be training all athletes. And I think that's very cool to see the success you've had with it. And I guess before we get off this show, can you tell us a little bit about one of your greatest moments when you were at the Olympics? Like, what was it like? Because you were the youngest athlete in the Olympics for your discipline, right?
Yes, I was once.
Yes, I guess there's a new one now. But can you tell us a little bit about that experience?
That wasn't the most exciting time of my life. I mean, that was like a learning. That's when I believed you just had to ride a little bit to be able to win a medal if you had a really good day. That's when I would call ignorance is bliss.
Okay, so you had ignorance is bliss. You kind of, let's say, you got a little bit lucky that you kind of got over there and started really busting your butt. What was your favorite experience?
My favorite experience was the Seoul Olympics, the bronze medal. But not because of the bronze medal, but because it's actually an interesting story. The Burns bought Dynasty when he was three, and he came back to Canada, and we trained in Canada. So he was completely trained in Canada, although we went to Europe. I always went to Europe three or four months before Olympics World, not for Seoul, because we went from Canada to Seoul, but 3 or 4 months before Olympics and Worlds, so that I could get my head in the game and not worry about teaching other people and all the dynamics of running a business, so that it was just my time with my horse and my coach. And that was really important to get my head in the game. Yeah. But going to Seoul, I trained here, and Neale, my husband, trained me. Like, he was also an excellent trainer and an excellent rider. And then Siegfried Pileka, who was the assistant German trainer at that time. He worked with Schulteis, my mentor and hero.
Right, right.
He came over and did some clinics that we went to, and then we left for Seoul and landed there. And we have our whole team. We have our vet, Alan Young, who was amazing. And then we have our chef to keep, and we have our coach, and so we all work together that way. And there was a lot of pressure on me because Dynasty was the top Canadian horse, and he was the youngest horse, the youngest Canadian horse. He was one of the youngest horses at the Olympics, actually. And I had this experience with this horse since he was three. And it was a great experience. He was very, very tough, 3, 4, 5 year old, and then almost overnight, later in his 5 year old year, he decided that he wanted to play the game. And then every day after that, he came and stepped up to the plate. So we were training hard. And then there was one, and so you rotate the arenas that you train in. So everybody gets a chance to train in different areas. And there was one arena that was really close to the forest. And every time we trained in that arena, Dynasty lost his mind. And I'm like, oh, this is like awful. And the Olympics are getting closer. And the Olympics, we were there 21 days before for acclimatization. And it was horrible, and I couldn't get his head together. I couldn't. It was horrible. And I thought, here, I've trained my whole life for this, and now I can't even get my head together. And so anyway, finally what I realized is that there were soldiers in the forest there, and they were with camouflage. So I didn't know they were there. Oh. But they were, because we were being protected, obviously. They do that at the Olympics. And right. So finally I said to my coach, I can't train in that ring. But then he started to turn the heat up with me and like push me and push me and push me and push me and push me. And Dynasty got more upset and more upset and more upset. And then it's one of the very few times I ever said anything to my coach. And so then we went through the Grand Prix. This would be 4 days out from the Olympics and from cantering down the center line. And so, literally there was a technical mistake in almost every movement. And then he pulled at the end. He goes, okay, that was all right, I guess. And I said to him, I said, how can you say that was all right? I was practically in tears, and I'm not a crier. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
I said that there was a technical mistake in almost everything. It was horrible. And he got mad at me, and so I went back, and I was one of the only ones riding twice a day, so I schooled early in the morning and then later in the afternoon, And so in that late in the afternoon one, he said, why don't you just take him for a hack around the racetrack? And I said, yeah, that's a good idea. So I did that. And then I phoned Neale and I said, I don't know what to do. Like, he's pushing me too hard. He goes, ugh, and the horse jumps. I said, I'm losing my horse. This is a horrible experience. And Neale said, well, you have to talk to him. And I'm like, what are you talking about? I have to talk to him, right? And I said, I already did, and it didn't go well. And then so then we sat together on the bus home from our venue to the Olympic Village. And like, with my heart, it was before, because he died the next year of colic. He was second in the World Cup, the highest a Canadian has ever been. And then when they called Dynasty's name, everybody stood up. He got a standing ovation, and like, the crowd went nuts.
That's awesome. That is really, really cool.
But I took a million chances. Like, my choreography was incredibly difficult, and the music was just really, really fun.
Now that's interesting. So you're the risk taker, basically saying, all right, I know what you guys normally do, but we're going to try this different thing. But you didn't do it because you were just some crazy rebel that wanted to stick it to the man. You were saying, no, this horse actually basically rides better to this music, so I'm not doing it for myself. I'm actually doing it for the horse.
Yeah, I mean, and he loved it.
So you were the rebel. You were basically listening to your horse and trying to figure out what works for them. But now the rest of the people probably didn't know that. So was there some backlash from the federations or any of the other athletes or coaches when you basically took this risk?
No, that people loved it.
They loved it.
They loved it. It was so the Germans went back and they had a meeting. I was told by somebody at the meeting.
Okay.
About, you know, where the placing should have been. And there was pretty much a unanimous decision that Dynasty should have won. And then they watched it and watched it and watched it. And in the canter work, that it was Feta. Oh, I can't remember. Anyway, it was Strauss, right? And there were triangles, ting, 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 and that was in the rhythm of the flying changes. So they loved that was doable, and that how difficult it was, how difficult the freestyle was, and yet it didn't ever look like the horse was stressed, or it just looked like we were doing a dance together. So it wasn't like the horse was under duress or anything. So I think that really captured the people, that this was so much fun.
So you showed them that, you know, they were, let's say they were somewhat, let's say, in the box with the style of routines that they would create, and you came in and basically opened up a whole box of creativity and said, here's what can be done if we actually really push for it.
Yes.
That is really, really cool. We're doing something similar with the trampoline world, and we're in a lot more of a political bind simply for a million other reasons. But these kids right now are taking the sport that is traditional in the box, literally, and basically just changing it and saying, you know, I'm going to invent this and I'm going to invent that. And, you know, some of them get hurt doing it, but these kids are running with this and they are changing the game. And that's why it's becoming a freestyle sport, which is also, again, like your sport, from the German background, but is now kind of finding its wheels on a whole nother front with this whole social media. And it sounds like you basically did that for dressage.
Before social media, yes.
That is so social media didn't help you. You were just doing what was actually best for the horse, which I think is beautiful, because that to me that's not capitalism. That's not someone just trying to get some social points. That's someone that just basically listened and did the best thing they could for their partner. And that's a response you get. That's awesome. That's great.
It was, you know, and that, I think that was a really exciting moment. And Schulteis was there, and he was so proud. And, you know, like, to please coaches of that quality is such a good feeling. That you've done it right. That you've listened to them. That you've learned from them. That you. You know, it was like there was a horse and I, like, we were one. It wasn't me and the horse. We were like one.
That is very, very cool. So now have you opened up Pandora's box, and now are you seeing a lot more creativity, or was that a flash in the pan?
I did see more creativity for a long time. I I'm not finding that I'm loving the music. A lot of people are getting music written for the horses. And I mean, so again, it becomes financially undoable. But I don't know. Like within one of the last freestyles I rode to a candy shop.
50 cent.
And take me to the candy shop. I took all the bad words out of everything. And again, the crowd went nuts.
That's awesome. Is that because of who you are and you were kind of the one that sort of did that first?
No.
Or is it the music?
No,
or?
No, it's because, again, it matched the horse.
Okay.
And the horse, the Piaf passage for the horse, it matched the horse. And it brought the best out in the horse. So, and again, people can see that. So that's why.
So you basically, you're saying that the your sport kind of evolved when people started thinking about making songs tailored toward the horse's feeling, not towards the athlete.
That's right. I mean, it can work both ways too. You can also do an emotional freestyle for yourself that you can bring out the best on the horse too. You just have to be really good at it.
But do you think, because you said that, are the athletes nowadays still kind of giving that, because you're saying they're making customized music, so is that the ultimate extreme of finding the rhythm for the horse, or is that a little too overboard?
No, that we did customize it somewhat.
Okay, so that's standard.
And I also couldn't, like, have all the swear words to take me to candy shop. Like, right. I couldn't have that in there. That would not be cool, right?
Oh, man, that'd be funny. The first one to have swearing and just gangster rap and all that sort of stuff. Oh, my gosh. You might not be like them.
So you know that song when it goes, whoa, right? Then I pee off.
That is cool.
And, yeah, so, I mean, the whole thing worked.
So will it just continue getting more creative, or is it going to just kind of sine wave back and forth to creative generation, not creative generation? Or do you think it'll change
anything? I can't really say. I can't really say. I am not particularly impressed with what I'm seeing at this point. I'm seeing fabulous athletes and horses on that. But I have seen a few freestyles that have moved me. And but generally speaking, I'm not being drawn into a story with them.
Okay.
So I don't know. I mean, I can't say what these people are going to do. They're certainly spending tons and tons and tons of money on them. So,
but they're not telling.
I don't know.
But they're not telling a story. They're just kind of mechanically going through the motions. You feel?
Not all, but most. Yes.
I feel the same way with our industry. This is why we wanted to start Freestyle Trampoline. It was the idea that you could get out of the box and start inventing your own movements in the air. You know,
yes.
And that's what I want, because it opens up all the creative possibilities, just different things to see. Because once I've seen, equestrian language, once I see a trot once, I don't need to see it again. I want to see something different. What can you do with this horse? Can you make this horse do a backflip? Can you make this thing roll around and you're still riding? Can you do like crazy stuff like that?
No, we're not allowed to do that. We have to stay within as a matter of fact, they've made it more difficult to be creative. Because they've put stops on certain things. Like I did, I halted way at the beginning, right before, like just when you get into the arena, and then I started with a double canter pirouette to one tempo, so skipping. One tempo is like a horse skipping to a double pirouette the other way, and now they're saying you have to canter three strides straight for a pirouette to count as technical difficulty. Then I did a half pass with a full pirouette in the middle of the half pass and continued in the half pass. Now I would have to do half pass, three strides straight, pirouette, three strides straight, half pass. Although the way I did it was much more difficult, because the people that make the rules don't train horses, generally speaking.
And that
also speaks to how that particular horse, right?
Right,
but
right.
Gymnastically, it is technically more difficult to go straight from a really quality half pass into a quality pirouette into a quality half pass, then to do a half pass, go straight, because then you're setting the horse up, pirouette, go straight, and then half pass. That's technically easier to maintain the quality of the half pass.
Okay, so it's still really technical, not really they're not enforcing creativity. They're not trying to see new movements, really.
I'm trying to think of the English word, schwerpunkt. They're not, what they think is difficult isn't necessarily difficult. Like, they're doing passage half passes, and for the newer breeds, the way they're breeding horses now with all this light movement and the legs flying all over the place, that's actually not as difficult.
Like the X Games, put a bunch of blocks and stuff like that and say you got 30 seconds to a minute. You got to run around and do rolls with the horse and do this and do, gallop over this block and this obstacle. It's not really like linear, like the poles that they jump over, but like literally blocks that they have to climb up and stairs, and you make a whole kind of arena and then try to move around. Could you do that with the horse? Like, could you train it to move around like an X game sort of thing?
That's called extreme cowboy.
Really? Is it? It's a thing?
It's a whole different thing.
What?
It's extreme cowboy. Well, they don't make them do rolls, but they do bizarre things, and they walk on bridges that were senior trotters, and they go through. Yeah.
Oh, that is
extreme
really
cowboy.
Okay. That is really why can you roll, like, if you start with the horse, could you roll it as thinking more like sideways, like it kind of lays on its side and flips
sure
over, and then
sure you can, but that's cowboy.
Oh, that is so cool. All right. Well,
and that's actually interesting. Actually.
That's fine. I like your statement there. That's actually interesting. Well, I really appreciate you taking the time to kind of teach us about, you know, just the big thing I'm taking away here is the relationship that you're having with the horse and how it can lift you up, you can lift them up, and just that subtleties that a lot of people don't realize go into any kind of coaching. It's amazing to hear just the way you kind of bonded with your horse, and I'm going to say your partner. I feel now bad saying horse now.
Well, he is a horse, but he was my partner and my best friend.
Well, that's awesome. I think anyone would love to have a best friend that was just like that and just was able to work with you the way you did. So congratulations on your career.
Thank
and
you.
Everything that you've done. It's really inspiring to just from a coaching perspective. So thank you for sharing your story with us.
Well, thank you very much. It was really a lot of fun for me to hear your perspective as well.
Yeah, it's coaches, we gotta share. And I want our industry to kind of get out of our industry, you know, to start thinking about what other coaches are doing, even though there's not all everything parallel. But there's definitely lots we can learn from just a different perspective. So I thank you so much.
You absolutely can. And you can also learn to be a critical thinker.
Well, that's tough for gymnastics because they tend to still do a top-down approach, and they haven't really learned to, let's say, really listen to the athletes quite yet. Mm-hmm. They're getting better, but there's still definitely some work to do.
Oh, I think in everything there is, but thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Have a great day.
Well, I hope you guys enjoyed and learned a few things. There's a big world out there worth exploring, and I'm happy to be able to bring these great experiences right to you through this podcast. If you enjoy this podcast and learn something, please share and take a screen grab of our funky cartoons and hashtag GRT certified for a chance to win a shout out to our community. Also, please leave us a review to be part of helping this information get out into the industry. It's much appreciated. Along with these podcasts, we have a large online content hub that we call the GRT Network, with many other interviews and full tutorials and written content discussing everything about acrobatics. We will be constantly growing this archive of videos like a cross between Netflix and Wikipedia for anyone in the acrobatic industry. We also have a complete online educational program for athletes of all levels that provides a do-it-yourself pathway to success for any acrobat. Check out our constantly growing library of playlists that will teach you anything from tightening up your social media, to how to get around fear, to even learning all the biology that underlies all your acrobatic skills. We work very hard with our team around the world to provide this exclusive content for you and appreciate any donations made to the FDA to help keep these episodes coming at you. And if you want all the content, become a GRT Network full member to get exclusive content before everyone else and access to special discounts and giveaways through our amazing global partners. Thanks, guys. See you next episode.